You're tuned to Radio Caroline on 199, your all-day music station.
Radio Atlanta, on our very first day, our Champers Day, bringing you brighter broadcasting and the finest sounds around.
Within the next few minutes, some lucky Radio Caroline listener could win as much as 1,560 quid.
This is Radio Caroline International.
This is the new Radio Caroline.
Mi amigo, mi amigo, mi amigo.
Radio Caroline.
This is not just a story about a radio station. It's about an idea that revolutionized the structure of radio in the United Kingdom and influenced the development of the British record market. It's a story about disc jockeys, engineers, pop groups, advertisers, and millions of radio listeners. For this is the story of Radio Caroline.
Caroline, the sound of the nation. Caroline, the sound of the land. Caroline, the sound of the nation.
The man who started Radio Caroline was an Irish businessman. His name, Ronan O'Rahilly.
I had been involved in the music business quite heavily. I got involved with, in fact I remember it well, I was involved in the club game, and then a friend of mine, a guy called Giorgio Gomelski, came to see me and said, come and listen to a band, you know. So off I went and I listened to a band called Alexis Corner Rhythm Blues Band. And in that band there was Charlie Watts on drums, later joined the Stones. There was Jack Bruce. We then, Ginger Baker joined the band when Charlie Watts left. And, but that was how I first sort of got a taste of the music scene. I discovered then that when I brought another artist I was working on called Georgie Fame, I bought a recording of Georgie around to a number of the record companies. In fact, a number. There were two record companies that counted then, EMI and Decca, and they had a total monopoly of the industry. They owned the distribution outlets, and they controlled, as I later found out, they controlled every piece of airtime on Radio Luxembourg. I mean, 70% of it. There were two other small companies, Pye and Phillips, who had, I think between them, about 12% of the market or something, because they had a little bit of airtime on Luxembourg. They had about equivalent amount of time. And no other record company could break that. I mean, it was an absolute solid monopoly. So I went to the two companies, EMI and Decca, with the recording of George, and I was told them, you know, both places that it was too early for coloured singers in Britain, which I was amused by, considering he was a Lancashire lad. Anyway, I then decided, right, I'm going to record him myself and go that route. You know, I wasn't conscious at all, by the way, at this point, of the monopoly. I just thought they just happened to be four record companies, and I didn't tie up anything else with it until I found myself sitting in Luxembourg with an acetate of Georgie and asking the then Luxembourg people, how many plays can you give me on this artist? I'm going to bring it out on my own record company. And the guy sort of almost fell off the chair laughing, you know, that anyone could be so ignorant or naive or whatever you like to call it. And he showed me these charts and wall boards on the wall with EMI show, Decca show, EMI show, Decca show, EMI show, Decca show. I mean, it was just absolutely, and then a tiny little Pi show and a tiny little Philips show down at the end, you know. So that virtually the entire Luxembourg airtime. So I went to the Beeb then, and the Beeb said they only played established artists on their one program a week or whatever it was. I can't even remember now. But I know they had, I think, a Top of the Pop show and a one or two other shows. I mean, there was so little exposure in the UK at that time. I mean, during the day, you just couldn't hear pop music. I mean, it was just barren, you know. We went on and, you know, at this point, and I thought to myself, my God, this is... And I remember sitting to the guy, because my mind just worked logically. And I said, well, look, if that is the case, then obviously... The next step is to, if you're not going to give me airtime, the next thing is to start a radio station. The next logical, you know, as you go through each stage, you have an artist that you think should have exposure. You go to the first stage and you find that, you know, the record companies don't want to, so you have to start your own record company. And then you find that if you have your own record company, nobody will play the thing because it's all tied up in a monopoly situation. You go to the next step, which is you start a radio station. And I said it to them there in that very morning. I mean, I wasn't sort of thinking about it for, you know, for 6 weeks. I just said, bang, bang, that's what you've got to do.
Caroline, the sound of the nation.
Caroline, the sound of the land. Caroline, the sound of the nation. Caroline!
I was very plugged into the Kennedys, right? I was a big, big fan of the Kennedys. From 1959, when I first sort of saw John Kennedy on television, you know, dialoguing and laying down the vibe. Just the whole vibe of him was, you know, got me like it got millions of other people all over the world. And I remember traveling across to the States to buy the transmitter gear. And I remember having this Look magazine or Life magazine, and there was a picture of Caroline Kennedy disrupting government. I remember that was the sort of, she was in the cabinet room or in his office or something. There was a meeting going on and she sort of climbed out from under the desk and disrupted everything, right? And instead of Jack Kennedy sort of having one of his aides, you know, get rid of her, I'm in an important meeting, he got involved with her leaving, you know, all these serious, powerful men sitting around twiddling their thumbs. You know, that was the story behind that. And the photograph that actually they had spread across the page, if I remember, was her climbing out from under the desk, sort of all smiles, and it was, the headline was Caroline, you know, upsets the apple cart, you know? I mean, it was that kind of imagery. It was the smile, the whole idea of... you know, the whole Kennedy kind of idea, which was to break new ground, to open new, to expand, you know, etc. To, you know, just a whole kind of the best of free enterprise with a lot of soul, you know. In other words, you know, that combination, which I think, you know, I've always thought was a very healthy combination. And it was just that whole imagery, and it was the headline, the Caroline thing, and I said, bang, that's it.
Caroline, sound of a nation. Caroline, sound of a land. Caroline, the sound of a nation. Caroline.
I later discovered, for instance, the most popular name in England, in fact, the most popular girl's name in England is Caroline.
Simon Dee explains.
We flew from Heathrow with a guy called Chris Moore, who was a sort of early program director, American friend of Ronan's, and we flew from Heathrow to Dublin, and then we drove on the coast road right up to Greenore, where I always remember it was the evening, and we came over a slight hill, and looking down on the port of Greenore, in it sounds terribly romantic, but it really was beautiful, and way down the bottom was this slender steel needle, which was the mast of Caroline, which is about 120 feet high. It's and that's where we started work on fitting out the first boat to get there, which was Ronan's boat, the Baltic ferry boat, Caroline. When we were there, coming over from Texas was the Mi Amigo, which was Crawford's boat. Well, we were getting on with the ship, we were gradually getting it together, and then on the horizon came the Mi Amigo, which had managed to batter its way across the Atlantic in appalling weather, saying, "Hey, you ready for us? Here we are, we want a bit of this number, we want a bit of this harbor, and we want to be fitted out too, of course, you see." So, there then developed rather a bit of, slightly unacceptable behavior from all of us, because the basic thing was here were two ships at one port, and both independent bosses, Ronan and Alan, both wanted the London anchorage. There were going to be two anchorages. There was going to be one off Frinton, and there was going to be one off the Isle of Man. Consequently, we were covering the whole of the UK. But both of us knew that the London anchorage up the Thames estuary was the richer of the two as far as commercials were concerned. So we both were aiming for this, so we both wanted to finish first. Well, Mi Amigo anchored behind us in Greenore, and one night we did a commando raid on board because the Mi Amigo had what were called spotmaster cassettes. And we didn't have spotmasters, folks. And spotmaster cassettes bring up commercials instantly. So you can sort of do amazing things and sound terribly professional. We didn't have any of these, so we mounted a Red Beret raid. Unfortunately, we weren't very good, because we were caught on board the ship by hordes of shrieking Dutch sailors, who were probably drinking hordes of Dutch gin, too. Anyway, it was a hell of an amazing scene. And sort of spotmasters were being clutched, and people were swearing at each other in various languages. So we turned out of Greenore, having fitted out the ship and with the crew on board. There was Chris Moore and myself were the only two voices on board, as far as I can remember, English voices. There were lots of Dutch people there, crew, electronics engineers, and the captain. We sailed away from Greenore, and this was on the Monday of Easter week, 1964, and then at exactly 7 o'clock on Good Friday evening, 1964, we dropped anchor, and it was dark, it was black, it was blowing a gale, the rain was coming down, it was amazing. And we could only see a few flashing lights ashore. People were running around the ship. And we decided, of course, knowing that we were going on air the following day, Easter Saturday, we'd have to test. We tested the equipment, and it seemed to work. It was pitch black. And we went to bed. Not that we really slept. We got up in the morning, and we had the tapes ready. In the control cabin. We were not going to do live records because we went too sure of the equipment in the sea rocking, so we had tapes for the first transmission, but we had to go live. The actual first announcement had to be live, obviously. So we waited for it to get light. Anyway, it was getting closer to the time. The gale was still going. I was reasonably nervous, of course. Everyone was nervous. Everything was ready. It was 11:30, and we checked the sig tune of Caroline, which was Jimmy McGriff playing Round Midnight, which was the code music of the station. We checked that a couple of times. I think the playing time of that track was something like 3:35, so allowing 30 seconds or so for speech. We started it at 4:00. It finished at 30 seconds to noon. Then I flipped the live switch and I said, "Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is Radio Caroline on 199, your all-day music station. We're transmitting music from now until 6 o'clock this evening, and a whole lot of other rhubarb, I said. I can't remember that. And one of the big 12-inch spools of tape started moving, and I cut myself out, and zap. And Caroline was on the air.
And when finally, you know, 12 o'clock arrived, and suddenly, you know, in she came. It was amazing. It wasn't amazing. I mean, you can't really describe the feeling. It's an impossible thing to describe.
Of course, together with this first transmission, we had the famous Caroline Bell, which was one of the characteristic sounds of the early days of Caroline. We'd bought a bell, and it figured on our publicity material, and that was ding, 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 ding. And that was always the case. Whenever we did any station breaks or changed programs in those first days, we always had the bell on a Spotmaster. And we know how we got those. So we were able to put the bell in.